Welcome, everyone, to this morning's virtual roundtable on assessing China's growth prospects after the 20th National Congress. And thanks and welcome to you, Michael. It's wonderful to have you back.
Thanks very much, Ben. Great to be back.
Well, Michael, let's jump right in. At 35,000 feet, the 20th National Congress is coming up in 1 month's time on October 16th. I suspect you're not expecting any radical changes in economic policy to emerge out of that. It's a coronation of sorts for President Xi Jinping. So what are China's growth prospects going forward for the coming 12 months or so?
Well, you know, it's easier to predict what will happen over the longer term than over the shorter term. Because over the longer term, we have a real systemic problem in China. China invests about 40 to 45% of GDP every year. That's the investment equivalent. This is an incredibly high number. The only higher number in history has been China about a decade ago when it was investing 50%. Before this, the highest number we've ever seen was for 2 or 3 years, South Korea invested roughly 40% of GDP. The US, I think, invests 15 to 20% of GDP. That's typical of most developed countries. Even high investing developing countries probably don't invest much more than 30%, right? So the Chinese investment rate is extraordinarily high by historical standards, by contemporary standards, by any standard you like. And it's been extraordinarily high for very, very long time, for 2 or 3 decades. Is that a bad thing or a good thing? Well, when you are hugely underinvested, then a very high investment rate is probably a good thing. And China, remember when it began the reform and opening up, had gone through 5 decades of anti-Japanese war, civil war, and Maoism. It was hugely underinvested. So this was exactly what the doctor ordered. But the problem with this growth model, and it's been the problem for every country that's followed this growth model, is that these very high investment rates close the gap between what you need, what you can productively absorb, and what you actually have. And once you've closed that gap, and for reasons we can discuss later, I think that happened about 10 or 15 years ago, then these very high investment rates are no longer justified. You have more and more investment in non-productive activity. Then we've discussed this in the previous times that I've been here. So what happens? Well, you have to bring down the investment rate. There's simply no way you can keep it at nearly this level. But most Chinese growth has been generated by these high investment rates. So as you bring it down, you run into problems. Growth slows significantly. And because investment is such a big share of GDP, it's highly pro-cyclical. A slowdown in investment will probably result in a slowdown in lots of other things, as we're seeing in the real estate sector. So one way or another, the investment share of GDP must come down. Now, there's only a few ways you can think about that. Every country has basically three sources of demand: consumption, investment, and external consumption and investment, or the trade surplus. If you're a small country, the trade surplus could matter a lot. But for a big country like China, we're probably at the limit of the amount of trade surplus it can run. So basically, it's investment or consumption. And as you bring investment down, the consumption share of GDP is going to rise. Now, arithmetically, there's two ways the consumption share can rise. One way is consumption is more or less flat and GDP growth drops to zero. And the other way, of course, is consumption picks up pace very, very rapidly and it maintains GDP growth, but it has to grow faster than GDP. The second way has never been done. It's not impossible, but it's extremely difficult to do because it requires enormous income transfers. So basically what I can tell you is in the next 5 to 10 years, the investment share of GDP in China will be much, much lower. The consumption share will be much higher In theory, it's possible for this to happen with a surge in consumption, but what's far more likely is a radical contraction in growth. Now, the reason I can't tell you what'll happen in the next year or so is because China still has debt capacity and they can still keep investment levels very high, even though they don't want to. Now, there are two major sources of investment, and these account for almost all of the non-productive investment. Of that 40 to 45% GDP share of investment, roughly one third historically has been in the property sector, and one third has been in infrastructure, and one third nicely has been in private sector and other areas. They've tried to constrain the growth in infrastructure, in real estate, as you know, and that's been incredibly painful, to the point where they're trying to increase investment in infrastructure in order to make up for the reduction of investment in the real estate sector. Now, that doesn't solve the problem. It just shifts it from infrastructure and real estate to just infrastructure. But that's the political choice they have to make. And within China, and that's why the Party Congress is so important, but within China, there are a group of people around the PBOC, the Ministry of Finance, the academic advisors, the economists among the academic advisors, who believe it's absolutely essential to get debt under control and allow growth to drop. But most of the political elite, the policy-making elite, the provincial party leaders, the provincial governors, the military, the foreign affairs group, they don't see why this great program that has worked for 30 years shouldn't be continued. So what really matters in the party Congress is which side wins the debate about economic policy. Do we slow down quickly, or do we continue with high growth rates, even at the expense of a continued surge in debt?
All right, let's dig in there a little bit in terms of who's actually making economic policy at any given time in China. For those of us outside, it's often difficult to tell. But let's say we could have a group of them in the virtual room right now. You could help identify for us who are the important players, and we could inject them all in truth serum. With truth serum, would a lot of them agree with you? Yes, sure, our investment levels are considerably higher than they should be right now, but we need to do this for social and political purposes. Or would there be a group who would be saying, no, Professor Pettis, you've got this wrong. We're still a developing country. These investments are strategic. They're necessary for our long-term growth prospects. We've thought this through. We've modeled them out. What is that dynamic among policymakers in China?
There are some people who would still disagree with me, including Yu Yongding, and someone I have a lot of respect for. He was among the first to understand the problem with the economy.
And tell the participants who Yu is.
Yu is in CAS. He used to be at Tsinghua, but he's in the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. He was on the monetary board of the PBOC, and he's pretty influential. He is probably the leading economist. There's a few others, but in terms of credibility and respect, I think he's the leading economist who continues to argue that we need to keep investment levels very high because that's the only way to grow out of the debt. I think he's completely wrong, but that's the argument. I would say most economists by now would agree with me. In the last couple of months, I've had two debates. It's under Chatham rules, so I can't tell you with who, but with very prominent Chinese economists who are very influential. And in both cases, we set these up as debates. There was supposed to be a disagreement. Frankly, there was no debate. The only disagreements among us was, you know, do you have more time or do you have less time? But everyone basically agreed off the record that there's no way that this is sustainable. We've got to bring debt under control. And we can only do that by bringing investment under control. And it's going to be very difficult to do that without a great deal of pain. Now, I said we agreed on most things. The major disagreement was, and I think this is a big problem, most of them think bringing debt under control and switching from low quality growth to high quality growth means a slowdown in growth to perhaps 4%, 3.5%. I think, frankly, that is insanely optimistic. I think if China is able to manage a sustainable high quality growth at 2 to 3%, even that to me would be quite surprising. I think it'll be quite hard to manage that. And if I'm right, that suggests to me that the next 2 to 3 years, we're really going to be fighting over what is the sustainable growth rate, because I think there still is an expectation of a much higher sustainable growth rate than I think is really possible.
Well, are there significant Chinese economic policymakers who would not only agree with you that the sustainable level of growth going forward is something in the area of 2 to 3%, but would consider that something that China needs to embrace? Or would they say no, that's just simply politically impossible, it can't be done here?
I can only tell you my impressions, because there are people who believe that they will never say it. But when I speak to people that I know very well, who are at a more junior level, people in their 40s, maybe in their 50s, many of them former students of mine, there is, I would say, an enormous amount of pessimism. People really are worried about the economy.
And let's talk a bit about one major component of the economy right now that is a subject of enormous debate in China, and that is the property sector. What should China be doing? It's been so significant in terms of China's economic growth that it doesn't seem that Xi Jinping can let go of that particular lever. What does China need to do, and what do you expect them to do going forward?
Well, what's really impressive is that Beijing doesn't seem to be eager to revive the property market. The desperation to revive the property market is at the local government level. And you can understand why. It's a huge source of their revenues. So revenues have basically collapsed because of the auctions, the land auctions, which on average accounted for up to 30% of total revenues, and in some provinces accounted for a lot more, particularly the worst provinces. That's come down significantly. On top of it, because of the COVID lockdowns, there's been huge corporate tax rebates. So other forms of revenue have come down significantly. Meanwhile, expenses related to COVID have soared, and some social spending, not a lot, but that's gone up a bit. So local governments have been really squeezed. Their revenues have gone way down. Their expenses have gone way up. Beijing has put significant pressure on them to constrain their borrowing. They're only allowed to borrow in order to build additional infrastructure to generate growth. And so they're really struggling. And the problem there is that as they struggle, they're doing things that are frankly making the economy much worse. So, for example, there were recent investigations into local governments who have been discovering that businesses in their jurisdiction have been committing all sorts of illegal activity, and they are fined for that. And the argument is that it's not really true. Nothing has really changed except the need for local governments to generate revenues. So fines have gone way up. One of my former students, who's a very successful manufacturer, who has manufacturing businesses in a wide variety of provinces, told me a couple of months ago that he had to create a holding company in Beijing and have all of the operating companies move their finances to Beijing. Because if local governments discover you have money in a bank, they will force you to make loans. Or in one case, he had to give a grant, a donation of 10 million RMB, which is about $1.5 million, to a local government. So these local governments are really struggling. And in doing so, they're further undermining the businesses in their areas by really squeezing them for income. You would have thought that at some point Beijing would have said, okay, this is a real problem. We've got to do whatever we can to revive the property market. But Beijing really hasn't. And at this point, I suspect it may be too late. Once you break this mentality, which had been, you know, very, very strong for a couple of decades, that real estate prices can only go up, then it becomes very hard to revive, particularly when you consider that the Chinese economy is roughly three quarters of the size of the US or of Europe. But residential real estate in China is valued at more than twice what American real estate is valued and more than three times what European real estate is valued. The last time we saw such crazy numbers were Japan in the 1980s. So there is a recognition that real estate is seriously overvalued. And it seems like from all of the polls, the PBOC does polls every quarter, it seems like the number of people in China who believe real estate prices will go up has fallen incredibly dramatically. And the ones who think real estate prices will go down has increased. Now, in a speculative market, and that's what we've been in, a speculative market for at least a decade, the reason you buy is because you expect prices to go up. Once you no longer expect prices to go up, you're not going to buy. On the contrary, you may have to start selling because now you're running a negative carry, particularly if you borrowed money to buy your apartment. As long as prices went up, it didn't matter. If prices are starting to go down, it's a big problem. So I think it's probably too late to revive the property market. I say probably because it's at least possible in theory next year if they eliminate the COVID lockdown and at the same time unleash a whole set of measures to try to boost property prices. They could reignite that speculative sense that prices are going up. I think the PBOC doesn't want to do that, but I think local governments desperately want to do that. So we're going to see a conflict between Beijing and local governments over what to do about the real estate sector.
Okay, you mentioned the zero COVID policy two times. For us outside observers, this looks unsustainable, but we haven't yet seen signs that Beijing plans to modify this policy significantly. In fact, they seem to be applying it on a wider and wider basis as these Omicron variants spread. What is your impression over the next year? Are we going to see further imposition of this hardline zero COVID policy, or are we going to start seeing changes in it?
That's the million-dollar question, Ben. It's really frustrating to try to figure it out. Last time I spoke with you, I told you that I regularly talk to my doctors and my nurses to try to get a sense of what they think about zero COVID. And back then I told you, it seems to me nobody believes zero COVID can possibly work. And I have to tell you, that hasn't changed. Everyone seems to think it's insane. No one will say that publicly, of course. But everyone thinks there's absolutely no way you can maintain zero COVID. And yet, as you say, there is no evidence at all that we're backing away from it. And the conventional wisdom, and I think it's probably correct, is that Xi Jinping has backed himself so much into a corner here that it's very difficult for him to walk away from it. Because old people in China are very reluctant to get vaccines. And I'm not totally sure why. But I've been told this many times, it's very hard to get the elderly to get vaccines. So if you have widespread of even the Omicron variety, the expectation is that you could get hundreds of thousands of deaths, maybe even a million. And that would be seen as extremely negative for Xi Jinping because he really took control of this policy. He took credit for this policy. I'm the one who has prevented people in China from dying. And if we suddenly see hundreds of thousands of deaths, you know, the concern is that that may really undermine its credibility. So we don't really know. You know, I remember when I left Manhattan, the joke there was that every conversation in Manhattan eventually becomes about real estate prices. Well, in China, every conversation becomes about when do you think zero COVID will end. We just don't know. We're all hoping sooner rather than later, but we have no idea.
All right, let's expand the discussion into the realm of foreign economic policy. With regard to overcapacity in China, government's primary means of dealing with this in terms of foreign economic policy has been overseas development, in particular, the Belt and Road Initiative. And that seems to be spreading debt problems globally. We've had massive debt crises, of course, in Sri Lanka, now Pakistan, et cetera, et cetera. What is your impression about where Belt and Road is heading? Is this centerpiece initiative really sustainable in any form going forward?
No, and I don't think anybody in China believes it is either. Both of the last two times we spoke, we discussed, you know, there's this perception that BRI is a form of debt trap diplomacy, and I think all of that is nonsense. What I think happened, and this happened not just to China, but it happened to the US in the 1920s, the Soviets in the 1950s, OPEC in the 70s, Japan in the 80s. It's a very common thing. When you first go out, you tend to underestimate the risk of developing lending, typically because when you first go out, it's during the global boom, everything does well. You tend to lend way too much. And then, like the US learned in the 1930s and on, that making loans is the easy part, collecting on loans is the tough part. And I've argued that 2015 was the hinge year. 2015 is when Chinese debt to Venezuela fell apart. It all had to be restructured. And I have a former student, I don't want to talk too much about it, but a former student who's involved in all of that. And I remember in 2015, because of Venezuela, there was real shock. There was the sense that, you know, this wasn't supposed to happen. This wasn't supposed to happen. And since then, if you look at Chinese development lending, it's come down pretty dramatically. And I think it'll continue to come down. But they are stuck in the typical creditor problem. If I lend you money and you can't pay me back, I have two options. I can lend you more money or I can write it down. And if I refuse to write it down, I have to lend you more money. So a lot of Chinese lending is of that sort, but I think they're really reluctant to do it. They don't want to do it, but they don't have an option. Pakistan is seen as a disaster. Sri Lanka is seen as a really big problem. Lots of problems in Latin America and in Africa. I honestly don't think that there is a clear policy there. I think it's just treat each problem as it arises, try to minimize the cost, and then move on to the next problem.
Okay, let's talk a bit about currency, particularly since Russia's invasion of Ukraine and the imposition of unprecedented Western financial sanctions, including on Russian central bank assets. There's been more talk about the need in China to wean itself off a dollar dependency. Where are we from a policy perspective in terms of addressing the costs and benefits of moving in that direction?
You know, a lot of talk, but there's nothing you can do. I have an article coming out in the Journal of Keynesian Economics. I think I am always confused about the publication dates, but it should come out in the next few weeks, in which I go through the logic of the argument. The problem is that if you need to run structural surpluses because you have deficient domestic demand, then you need to acquire assets abroad. Where are you going to acquire assets? Well, you can't really in Japan or Europe, because both of those countries are running current account surpluses. They themselves are acquiring assets abroad. More recently, they've switched into deficits for temporary reasons. But generally, they're not big net acquirers of, they're not net sellers of domestic assets. You should be acquiring assets in developing countries, but that's turned out to be incredibly risky. And as you know, I use the data that you guys provide, the trade data, which I find extremely useful. But roughly 10% of excess savings go into developing countries. There is no way anything much greater than that can possibly be absorbed. So what do you do? Well, basically, you have to acquire assets in the United States, which accounts for roughly half of all excess savings, or in the other US-type financial markets, the Anglophone markets, England, Canada, and Australia, which account for most of the rest. So this argument that you can run trade surpluses and not acquire dollars, you know, it just doesn't work. The arithmetic doesn't work. There was recently news that a lot of people thought was very important. I don't think it's very important at all, that China was going to sell gas to, Russia was going to sell gas to China.
Yeah.
And it would be paid half in rubles and half in renminbi. Well, when you go through the arithmetic, none of that works, right? What will China do with the renminbi? Well, if they accept payment in renminbi for the government, or rather, if they make payments, then either the Chinese trade surplus has to come down by the amount of Russian gas purchases, and given the structure of the economy and its dependence on surpluses, that's very difficult. Or they have to recycle those payments. And where can they recycle them? Well, again, you have the same set of options. You can recycle them in US, Europe, Japan, although in Europe and Japan, it's very difficult to. Or you can recycle them in other developing countries. And if you don't want to recycle them into other developing countries, then you must buy US or British or Canadian assets. You really don't have a choice. So, you know, there's a lot of talk. My entire life, we've heard this story, the end of dollar dominance. It's very difficult as long as countries need to run surpluses, and the only real corresponding deficits are likely to be in the US or the other Anglophone economies. It's extremely difficult to shift away from the current currency regime.
Okay, I'm going to be opening up the discussion shortly. I just wanted to remind you that if you'd like to ask a question, you should click on the raise hand icon. One more question from me for now, Michael. U.S. Economic policy toward China. One thing I certainly did not expect in the transition from the Trump administration to the Biden administration was that trade policy would remain essentially static. That pretty much all the tariffs would remain. That the approach would be nearly identical, and Congress seems absolutely fine with that. What is your impression of where U.S. policy towards China is on the economic front?
The problem with the Trump approach is that they were right to be very worried about the impact of these deficits on the US economy. The mistake they made was to think that tariffs were the way to address this. They simply weren't going to address this at all. They would likely have almost no impact. And if they had an impact, all they would do is reduce the bilateral deficit with China and increase the deficit with the rest of the world. All they could do is shift the deficits around. And the reason is because the role of the U.S. is to absorb excess savings from the rest of the world. And as long as China has excess savings, which has nothing to do with tariffs, those excess savings have to be exported. And one way or another, they're going to end up in the U.S. So tariffs weren't going to make an impact. So as I see it, the tariffs were sort of a waste of time. And when the Biden administration came in, it seemed to me that they were unlikely to eliminate the tariffs, partly because from a political point of view, the tariffs are very pleasing. It seems like the US is doing something about China, even though it's doing nothing. And I thought the inflation argument was always nonsense. The argument that if you reduce tariffs, that will reduce US inflation. That's based once again on a really big misunderstanding of the imbalances that have led to the inflation. So at the end of the day, I think the reason they've maintained the tariffs is because they believe, probably correctly, that this gives them a certain amount of leverage in other areas, but ultimately they don't matter that much.
Okay, I will remind participants, if you'd like to ask a question, you should click on the raise hand icon. We've already got a number of questions in the queue. First one from Bob Rubin.
Can you hear me, Mike?
Yes.
Good, okay. Michael, I have the following question, and it may be a little bit of a not so, maybe it's a little bit of a dumb question, I don't know. But I'd had the impression that the real problem in China was not a demand problem, but it was age demographics, the drought, environmental problems, the role of the Communist Party seems to, increasing role they seem to be taking in private enterprise, so-called private enterprise and so forth. But the real problem was supply problem. But you're saying now that the real problem is demand problem. If the real problem is demand problem, why can't they just do what Keynes, if I remember correctly, said something about just fund it with debt? You build bridges to nowhere, but you've created demand, and then you have an economy. Oh, and I forgot to leave COVID in the demand in the supply side problems too.
You're right; it's clearly a demand problem, and I think in China it's widely recognized as a demand problem. But how do you solve the demand problem? Well, you one way or another, you end up transferring income to the household sector. You can do that through fiscal stimulus, the way it was done in the US or in Europe. You can do that by eliminating the hukou. You can do that by giving, instead of building luxury apartments, building cheap apartments and giving them to the poor. There's lots of ways you can do that. The problem is one that Albert Hirschman identified way back in the 1960s and 1970s when he was talking about this growth model. His argument was that after many years, and in China, it's been many years, about three decades of what seems like a very successful, and what was for a long time, a very successful growth model, there are certain constituencies disproportionately powerful, and ones that prevent. So in theory, or instead of to the highest bidder to convert into luxury apartments, create cheap housing and give it away to the poor. The problem there is that you require a major shift in income from the government sector to the household sector, right? The reason consumption in China is so low, and it's the lowest ever recorded in history, is pretty straightforward. Households retain the lowest share of GDP ever recorded in history. In the US, households get roughly 80% of GDP. In Europe, 70 to 80%. Even in low consuming, high savings developing countries, households retain roughly 65 to 75% of GDP. In China, they retain 55%. So if you want China to become even a low consuming country, and after so many years of being the lowest consuming country in history, they probably need to go well beyond that. But let's just say, make them a normal low consuming country. You have to shift roughly 10 to 12, you know, depending on what percentage of that income gets consumed, but roughly 10 to 12 percentage points of GDP from local governments to the household sector. And that means, you know, local governments retain roughly 20% of GDP. So you would have to shift income more than half of their income to the household sector. And what Hirschman argued, and I agree, we've seen this in China, is that it's incredibly difficult to do this without significant political reform, and reform in particularly in political, business, and financial institutions. So they've been talking about doing this since 2007, 2008. But they haven't been able to do it. It's very difficult to do. The arithmetic is simple. The politics is very, very difficult. And that's really going to be the big thing we're going to be facing in the next 3 to 4 years, in my opinion. If you want to rebalance without an incredible slowdown in growth, you need to transfer income. So the question is, from whom? From the central government in Beijing or from the local governments? And my guess, and it's only a guess, is that it's going to be the local governments, but not after a ferocious struggle between Beijing and the local governments.
Michael, what always comes up in our conversations is the degree to which Chinese economic policy has really broadly been going in the wrong direction since Xi Jinping took power. I mean, you've been in Beijing that whole period. How much of that should we put down to the man himself, Xi Jinping, and how much should we put down to inexorable political forces that were already moving things in that direction in China? That is, it would have been similar whoever took power in 2012.
Yeah, you know, there's a big debate in China between whether Xi Jinping has screwed up and has moved China away from the correct path. The implication being that if only we go back to that correct path, we can have 6 or 7% growth again forever. And the different view, which is that this was an inexorable development of the growth model. And, you know, to be a little bit cynical, I would say those who were probably excessively bullish about China now say we were wrong because of this ideological shift on the part of Xi Jinping, which we didn't expect. I think that's wrong. And I think if you read, you know, Janusz, you know, the Hungarian economist, Janusz Kornai. Janusz Kornai wrote about this a great deal. What he said was that the real difference between economies like the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact economies in China and that of the West is the role of soft budget constraints. In the US, you have hard budget constraints. You can engage in non-productive behavior up to a point, and then you go bankrupt and you write it down. So there's a constraint on your ability to engage in non-productive behavior. But Cornet pointed out that in the economies of the Soviet Union, Warsaw Pact, and China, there is no such constraint because so much of the economy occurs through the government sector in which there are no budget constraints. They have unlimited borrowing capacity. So under those conditions, Cornet argued that in the beginning, you have very rapid, healthy growth. Again, as you're closing the gap between what you need to invest and what you are investing. But once you've closed that gap, more and more of economic activity is non-productive. And because the private sector won't engage in non-productive activity, it must be the public sector that does so. So way back in my 2013 book, I argued we have to see an expansion of the public sector because that's the only way to maintain these high growth rates. As long as the GDP growth target exceeds the real underlying growth rate of the economy, you have to have a shift from the private sector from the hard budget constraint sector to the soft budget constraint sector. So people like me, and there's a few of us who've been arguing this, have argued that the increasing role of the government in the economy was not an ideological shift. It would have happened anyway. As long as you have GDP growth targets that exceed the real growth of the economy, you have to have this shift. And the implication is very different. The implication is that you can't go back to 7% growth rates. We can suddenly decide that, you know, we're gonna go back to all of the conditions of 5 or 7 years ago. It doesn't matter because it doesn't change the underlying problem, which is that the only way to maintain high growth rates is with increasing shift of the economy towards the public sector and a surge in debt. So as long as you allow the surge in debt, you can keep these growth rates. The moment you try to control the surge in debt, there is nothing you can do. Growth rates are going to drop dramatically.
Can you clarify, at what point does unsustainable growth become literally unsustainable and stop growing? What is the dynamic there?
We don't really, it's very hard to predict that because there are so many moving parts. And it depends on, among other things, it depends on perceptions. But what we do know is that there is no such thing as infinite debt capacity. If there were, it would be trivial to make everybody a millionaire overnight. We know that there's a limit to your ability to engage in non-productive behavior and rising debt, because ultimately the debt itself, if it's not paid from the project in which it was invested, it must be paid in the form of transfers. And eventually the transfers become big enough that they have to undermine economic growth. Now, when does that happen? We don't know. You know, you can predict that something is unsustainable and you can be right. But when you predict when it becomes unsustainable and reverses, you're almost always wrong. We just don't know. But more importantly is that it seems like the economic policy makers and their advisors in Beijing believe that it's unsustainable. They believe they have to address it. So that's probably what's going to drive it. We're not going to reach the capacity and collapse. We're probably going to adjust before that.
Okay. Next question from Tara Hariharan.
Thank you so much. My question pertains to how China can manage this understandable drop to lower growth rates in the medium term when it also has at least two different stabilities to consider. The first of all is social stability. I mean, we're already hearing about fairly high unemployment rates, particularly youth unemployment rates. And the second is capital flows stability, because people are, of course, also watching the Chinese yuan. But we've also seen for a good portion of this year, capital outflows in the form of foreigners selling Chinese bonds and Chinese stocks. So from that perspective, how can China balance those stability concerns with this reality that growth will have to slow down and be of better quality? Thank you.
That's a great question. And I think there's a lot of historical precedence because, you know, this growth model, this high savings, high investment growth model wasn't invented by China. You could argue it was invented. You can go all the way back to the American system of the 1830s, but you can argue that this version of it was invented in the 1930s by the Soviet Union and by Germany. And there have been many, many cases of it. And it seems like there are typically two ways in which the adjustment takes place. I call them the American way and the Japanese way. The American way is in the form of a very brutal, rapid crisis. So in the United States in the 1930s, for example, you know, people don't realize this, but in the 20s, we had the problem of excessively high savings rate, non-productive investment, huge trade surplus, many of the similar problems as China. And the way we adjusted in the 30s was in the form of a brutal contraction in GDP, about 35% contraction in GDP, and a brutal but much less brutal contraction in the household income share. Household income contracted by around half of that. So you'll notice the household share of GDP rose and we eventually started growing again. It was a very difficult period, but we did it. Brazil in the and after 82, 83 adjusted in very much the same way with a huge contraction in GDP and a smaller contraction in household income, still quite brutal. The Japanese way, we never saw that brutal contraction. What we saw was that it was spread over a long period of time. So before 1990, Japan's GDP grew at whatever, 5%. Household income grew much slower than that, roughly 3%. After 1990, GDP growth collapsed to 0.5%. You would think that would be devastating for the household sector, but it wasn't. They didn't revolt. There was, you know, stability was maintained. And I would argue the reason is because household income continued to grow quite rapidly relative to the 1980s. It grew by roughly 1.5% while GDP was growing at 0.5%. And when you consider that the population was contracting by roughly 0.5%, that was a 2% per capita increase in household income, which was in line with what was happening in the United States at the time. So for a rich country, that wasn't very bad. So what's the lesson? The lesson is you can do a very rapid adjustment, which over the long term is probably better, but over the short term is socially and politically very painful. I don't think politically China can absorb that kind of investment, but you can also do a long-term Japanese-style investment, which over the long term is probably worse for the economy for a whole bunch of reasons, but you never have that really jarring, brutal adjustment. And if China is, let's say that GDP growth in China drops to 2%, but they adjust with household income and household consumption growing at roughly 4%, that's a pretty good outcome. not counting the last couple of years where household income growth has been flat. Before that, household income was growing at roughly 5%. So if you can manage this transition with household income growing at 4%, that's not a disaster for most Chinese. Even 3% is not a disaster. Well, that's just a long way of saying that the contraction in GDP growth will not be evenly spread out if they do it correctly. More than 100% of the contraction will occur in the form of investment in the manufacturing sector, and there will be only a small contraction in the household sector. So politically, it shouldn't matter. Now, can they pull it off? I don't know. That's really a political question that has to do with the distribution of power, not just between households and the government, but probably more importantly, between Beijing and the local governments. Because the key is, if you manage this less traumatic adjustment, that means the cost of the adjustment has to be absorbed, probably not by the business sector, probably by government, in which case the key question is which government, Beijing or the local governments. And that's why I tell my clients that I think the most important conflict over the next 2 to 3 years, there'll be two. One is between Beijing and local governments over who absorbs the cost of adjustment. And the other, which I haven't really gotten into, but I'll just throw it out, is between the good provinces, the ones that are growing quite quickly and that have minimum levels of debt, versus the rest of the country, which is doing very poorly and has enormous amounts of debt. So I'm going to cop out by saying that this is really a political issue and I can't predict it, but that's what we have to focus on, how the politics of the solution work out.
Okay, next question from Jeff Schaefer.
Here. You've given us a good update on where China is. I'm struck that more than 5 years ago, I heard almost the same thing from you and agreed with you then. They have been very successful in kicking the ball down the road. But my question is, what in the toughening international security situation, rising tension over Taiwan and with the US, what's the likelihood that a lot of this needed spending winds up in defense infrastructure and defense hardware? And we have an accelerated arms race.
Well, probably that's going to happen. But from an economics point of view, whether you invest in empty apartments or in bridges to nowhere or in the defense establishment, it's the same thing. It's all non-productive. It's a cost. It doesn't really generate growth. So I think they will do that. And I think, you know, that's part of the story of what happened in the Soviet Union in the 1980s. But it's not really a solution to the economic problem. The reason I think things may be different today than they were 5 years ago, you know, 5 years ago, we were saying this is unsustainable, but we don't know when it will stop. There are two ways it can stop. One way it can stop when it reaches the point where credibility collapses and you just can't go forward and you have a crisis. The other way it can stop is when the government decides that it's unsustainable and we must stop it. And there is quite a lot of evidence that the government believes that it's unsustainable and must stop it. And the strongest evidence, as I don't need to tell you, is how hard they came down on the real estate sector. That turned out to be brutal. I think they underestimated how painful it would be. But Beijing still doesn't seem like it wants to pull away from what they did to the real estate sector. So my sense is, and this is just a sense, there are 50 to 100 people who know, and I'm not one of them, but my sense is that there is a recognition, at least among the policy, the economic policy making elite, that we've reached the limit to this growth model and we have to shift. Military spending doesn't really help. It helps in the sense that you don't have to build bridges to nowhere. You can build more tanks. Maybe that's better, you know, but as an economist, to me, it makes no difference. In both cases, it's non-productive investment.
Okay, next question from Lyric Howe.
Michael, thank you so much for sharing your insights from Beijing. So valuable for everyone today. My question is really, you've heard me ask this before, I think, but the obvious answer is to the local national business funding problem is local property taxes. And that would also help with the property bubble. Do you see any visibility for people who don't know, China has no property taxes. And that's a reason that these local governments struggle to find funding and sometimes find it in all the wrong places. Thank you.
Yeah, you may remember, I think last time I was here, I was very skeptical about property taxes. You're absolutely right. They make tons of sense. But here's the problem. 20 to 25% in Beijing more of the apartments are empty. Now, how can you possibly keep an empty apartment? There's no carrying costs. And as long as prices go up, you know, that's fine. There's no difference between an empty apartment and a long-term deposit in the bank. The moment you introduce property taxes, then there is a negative carrying cost on property. And that means that you have to earn income from that property. Now, prices in China are extraordinarily high, probably 4 to 5 times what they should be relative to a normal a real estate market, right? At least 3.5 times. But one of the counterbalances to that is that the rental yield is incredibly low. In China, rental yields are roughly 1% to 2%. I live in a really beautiful courtyard house. I wish I owned it. I don't. It's probably worth over $10 million. But the rental yield is about 1%. You know, that's manageable. But here's the problem. If you put property taxes, meaningful property taxes, that means that there is now a negative carry on real estate and you have to rent it out if you don't want to run a negative carry and if you don't believe prices are going to go up. But with rental yields so low and with roughly 1/4 of all apartments empty, imagine what would happen if even half of those were thrown into the market. That would drive down rental yields even lower so that they wouldn't be enough to cover the property tax. In which case, what do you do? If you own an apartment, you are now losing money every year and you're not making it up for it with rising prices. On the contrary, prices are probably going to decline. So what do? You have to sell. And if enough people sell, that puts even more downward pressure on housing prices. And so you get caught up in that self-reinforcing process where declining prices encourage sales and sales encourage declining prices. And Beijing clearly doesn't want that. They would like to see prices stabilize or decline slowly. And if they were to implement property taxes, we would almost certainly see a rapid decline in property prices. So I never believed that they would implement them. And I think that's not going to happen for a few more years.
Well, isn't the other issue that they're a mechanism of corruption, that they're a currency of corruption, apartments, for example, in China? But isn't the real answer just to phase them in very slowly so you start to create income flows for the local governments?
The problem is the adjustment. You know, in Beijing, an apartment, the average square meter costs more than it does in New York City, even though New Yorkers have 5 to 6 times the income of Beijingers. So prices are just way too high. If you believe New York real estate is correctly valued, and it almost certainly isn't, but if you believe it's correctly valued, Chinese real estate prices are incredibly overvalued. And there's no way you can get around that. Ultimately, prices always converge to some conception of fundamental value, which means that prices are going down. The only interesting question is, do they go down very quickly or do they go down very slowly? And I think Beijing would like to see them go down as slowly as possible.
Okay, next question from Joanna Shelton.
Sorry, the unmute was slow to come. Good morning. I'm Joanna Shelton with the Center for Strategic and International Studies. We all know that China's demographics pose a problem for future growth. And I wonder if you could just delve into that picture a little bit more for us and see how you tell us how you see it unfolding in the years to come and its implications for future growth.
You know, in the long term, I think they have a really serious demographic problem that matters in terms of the distribution of economic and political power around the world. But in the medium term, and I think China's problem is really a medium term problem, they've got to resolve this before they can worry about the long term. In the medium term, the demographics matter much less than I think people think they do. First of all, it's occurring slowly, but more importantly, the key demand question in China, the key question in China is deficient domestic demand. And what drives domestic demand is the income of the household sector. So if China is able to raise the income of the household sector, the income share of GDP of the household sector, whether that's with a declining population or a stable population almost doesn't matter. What really matters is the household income share of GDP. So the key is whether they can raise that. If they raise that, then even a declining population will result in an expansion of domestic demand, and the private sector invest primarily based on their expectations of domestic demand. So if we can shift money, if we can shift income to the household sector, consumption will go up and productive private sector investment will go up and the economy will do fine. If they don't shift that income, then consumption will stagnate, productive private sector investment will stagnate. And the only way out for China is with a growing trade surplus, and they're too big to depend on that, or with more non-productive investment. And you can't do that forever. That's unsustainable. And that's pretty much the way I see the Chinese problem. So as I said, demographics matter in the long term, but they don't matter that much in the short and medium term.
Okay, I've got one more question on my screen, although I don't have a clear name attached to it. It says Co-Hunter. Can you identify yourself?
Apologies. It should say Constance Hunter with AIG. Michael, great to hear from you. In thinking through how China's sort of realization or transition to a permanently lower growth rate impacts the rest of the world. That could play out, and I guess it depends, you know, the policy steps or missteps. You could lay out some of the most likely scenarios you see this development impacts the rest of the world.
Again, I think that's a really important question, Constance, because I think there's a lot of misperception about it. You often hear people say that China is the global growth engine and a slowdown in China will be devastating for the world. And I think that's completely wrong. The global growth engine is demand, and China has been providing large amounts of negative demand into the rest of the world. What I would argue is that the impact of China on the rest of the world depends on how that impact affects the balance of payments, because ultimately the way China, the way any country reacts with the rest of the world is through the balance of payments. And the story I always tell, and I think I told it last time I was here, is imagine if in 1990 somebody had predicted that for the next 10, 20 years, Japan would grow at 0.5%. Well, obviously you would have laughed at him because that couldn't possibly be true. But if you believed him, you would have said that's devastating for the world because Japan is the global engine of growth. Well, in fact, Japanese growth collapsed to 0.5% and the world shrugged it off. It had no impact on the rest of the world. And the reason I would argue is because if you look at the Japanese current account surplus, as Japan rebalanced, as the consumption share of GDP went up, savings contracted, and the gap between savings and investment came down. So the Japanese current account surplus as a share of global GDP actually declined during that decade. So Japan actually contributed demand. Its terrible economic performance actually contributed net demand to the rest of the world. And I would say that that could also happen with China. If China adjusts in the form of a collapse, that would be devastating because Chinese demand would drop even faster than Chinese supply, and the net impact on the rest of the world would be to suck out demand. If China adjusts the way Japan did, a long, slow rebalancing in which GDP growth dropped very, very low, but household income growth and consumption growth didn't drop as much, then what we would see is a contraction in the Chinese current account surplus, and that would provide net demand for the world and would probably be slightly positive for the world. But it wouldn't be positive for everybody, because when you consider that the Chinese growth model makes it a consumer of industrial metals and cement to an extent that we've never before seen in history. Even the United States did not consume the share of steel and copper, et cetera, as China did during its highest period. China consumes roughly half of all of the metals, cement, et cetera, produced in the world. A slowdown in China will result in a collapse in investment, not a collapse in consumption. So that means that probably Chinese demand for industrial commodities will collapse and their prices will drop. So if you're a Brazil or an Australia, that's devastating. But if you're a net importer of industrial commodities, like most countries are, that's actually the equivalent of a tax cut. That's actually quite positive. Food is a different thing. If China adjusts with a continued reasonably high growth in consumption, then Chinese consumption of food will continue to rise, particularly as higher incomes drive them up the calorie scale. So China will continue importing lots of food commodities. So what I would argue is that a rapid slowdown in China is not bad for the world. It's probably marginally good for the world, depending on how it happens. But that marginally good is an average, and that average conceals an enormous amount of variation. Some countries will do very well out of a Chinese slowdown, and some countries, primarily the industrial commodity exporters, will do very badly out of a Chinese slowdown.
Well, we've come to the end of our hour, so it remains for me just to thank you, Michael, very, very much on behalf of the Council for yet another extremely productive and interesting discussion, and we really look forward to having you back. Thank you, Michael.
Always happy to come back. Thank you. Bye-bye.